Good evening. Welcome to RAK Talks, our weekly Sunday seminar series. So a very happy new year to all of you gathered here. I'm glad to see all of you here on this brand new 2021. After a roller coaster of what 2020 was, we're so glad we have cruised through, sailed through, and we have landed in 2021. So welcome. Welcome to RAK Talks. And here we are yet again with another very, very interesting session. So what do we have in store for you today? Well, you know, I mean, a lot of people have difficulty when it comes to language, right? Sometimes we have a mental block, you know, we don't really adapt to languages that easily, you know, it's difficult, it's not easy. So how do you approach a language? Okay, and today with special reference to English, how should you approach a language? So that is what we are going to talk about today, but that's for later. We have so many fun activities planned for you. So are we ready to get going? Can we have some responses on the chat box? All right. So every week, as all of you are aware, we bring in some wonderful performances by our very own students. And this week, we have the students of the Avadi branch. So to start off with a fun, wonderful, stunning performance, we have Kanishka.
Yo, honey singer.
Thank you. That was a brilliant performance. Thank you so much, Kanishka. All right. So moving on to the next performance, yet again from the Avadi branch, we have Sanjana. Awesome. Thank you so much, Sanjana. That was brilliant. What rhythm, what clarity. Excellent. Thank you so much. All right. Okay. And the final performance of today, we have Yashwini again from Avadi Junior Inter Batch.
Bounce with it, girl. Dance with it, girl. Get with it, girl. Put a bang, bang.
Come on, come on. Turn the radio on. It's Friday night and I won't be long. Gotta do my hair, put my makeup.
Yeah.
Thank you so much, Yashwini. That was brilliant. Thank you so much. All right. Okay. So I congrats to all the students from the Avdi branch. Your performances were brilliant. So now, with no further delay, it's now time to introduce the speaker of the day, Miss Bharati Lakshmi. It's a privilege to have you here to say a few words about Miss Bharati. She is a postgraduate in English literature and psychology, having more than 25 years plus experience in serving institutions of repute in various capacities, right from TGT to teacher education, academic coordination, and administration. She seeks to making the profession more meaningful and objective oriented and strives for excellence in the assigned and accepted role. And she has been, right now she's the principal of the Hindustan International School, but she's also been the principal of Wales International School and the headmistress of Chettinad Vidyashram and many more roles she has served. And talking about her achievements, she has won the Best Teacher Award for Excellence in Education, organized by Rustam Irani Foundation, Mumbai, nominated for the Japanese Scholarship by the Management for Fellowship. She's been a panelist in a debate on whether the teaching profession has lost its charm on NDTV Hindu. She's a regular speaker on radio talk shows with regard to education and teaching. She's received the Ideal Headmistress Award from the National Institute of Students Development Society, Pune. And it goes on and on and on. I can go on for a long time. Ma'am, we are thrilled to have you here. So over to you.
Good evening, everyone, and a very happy new year from me to you. Sandhya, did you wonder why I wasn't talking for a few seconds after you introduced me?
Yes, actually.
Despite me being there on the screen and then I refused to react. I was busy fiddling with my phone and looking everywhere around. Why do you think I did it?
Maybe it's an indication of what we're not supposed to do during the session.
Well, that's a part of it. But the other indication is, what do you think I was trying to communicate in those few seconds that you saw? I apparently was listening, but was not listening. I was looking everywhere around me. What do you think I was communicating to you? Sandhya, I'm sorry.
Physically present, mentally absent.
Well, that's okay. Anything else? Sandhya, you're going to be my guinea pig for quite some time now.
I realize that.
Children, parents, everybody else, you can give me your answers. What do you think I was trying to do by not responding, but only showing my gestures for some time to Sandhya?
Is it called body language?
That's a wonderful answer, body language. And it is a part of non-verbal communication. Now, before I go into it, I would like to thank Ramana and his team for having me over to share my views on understanding language in its best possible way. Ramana, thank you so much. And the best thing I can remember about Ramana and his team is when they teach dance, I always remember Ramana had told all the children around, he said, not just your body, let your soul dance and soul speak along with you. And today I realized when he is doing this Rack Talks and the kind of, because I've been seeing his brochures and advertisements about Rack Talks, I realized he's doing the same thing with the talks also. He's not just allowing the soul to, you know, perform in a form of dance, but trying to understand in its best possible way. So Ramana, kudos to you and your team. And thank you so much for having me once again.
Thank you.
And Sandhya, you're, I think, an asset to Ramana because you're a wonderful host and I kind of adore your language. He's got the right people at the right place. Okay, coming to the language part. I have a question for all of you, those of you wish to answer. What is the first sound that you heard as soon as, if it's not too early going back to your childhood, what is the first sound you think you heard as a child or as far as your memory can take you?
Ma'am, crying, ma'am.
How sweet, baby. Who's that little one telling me crying?
Ma'am, Samira.
Samira, did you hear yourself crying or did you hear somebody else crying?
Ma'am, I heard like myself crying.
How sweet is that? You heard yourself crying. And what was the other sound that you heard apart from you crying? Of what you can remember?
Then my mom's voice.
Exactly, mom's voice. And what do you think was the first word mom would have told you? You know what? Let me tell you, Samira, when all of you little ones out there, when you were small babies, we mothers start speaking your language. We don't make sense. And all that we want is to have a connect with you. So we start babbling and making all those kuchi-kuing sounds. Now, what do you think all those sounds are? Can anyone answer me? I want Ramana or somebody else taking this.
Table etiquette.
Beg your pardon? Beg your pardon, ma'am?
Table etiquettes.
I'm not going to table etiquettes. I want to know what those sounds are.
It's like...
What were those sounds which a mother and child spoke?
They say Malayali. They say like...
Marala, yes, but did those sounds make any sense?
No,
but it made a lot sense to the baby who was listening and to the mother who was speaking, or vice versa. It made a lot of sense to them because both understood. It didn't have a syntax, it didn't have a meaning. All that it had was sound and a lot of emotion to it. And that's what exactly I'm trying to tell everyone out here is, language is nothing but all of emotions. And those of us who kind of, I hear some nice little sounds now. And those of us who kind of read a bit of philosophy or something, if you go back to the Hindus, they say the first sound was Om. If you go to the Muslims, they say that probably the first sound was of what Allah said. The Christians might call it what Christ said it. So, you know, for each religion, it differs, but basically we attach a lot of, you know, spirituality to sound. I call it language is nothing but of emotions. Of how and what you would like to connect with somebody whom you love or don't love at all. So the first few seconds, all that I was trying to say is, without even opening my mouth, without using words, I was trying to say something. I knew Sandhya had told me I was supposed to respond, but I didn't speak at all. My gestures were speaking. And somebody said body language, yes. So going a little more into body language, it's verbal and non-verbal communication. Sometimes language is not all about speaking. It's sometimes without even speaking, you convey a lot. I'm sure we've all seen lovely movies like Muri in Hindi. And if you go back to Hindi, old movies, Koshish and all, we had a whole beautiful movie where the characters never spoke, but they connected a lot. So when you want to understand language, I request the parents to understand one thing, that language is nothing but of sounds. The first time you as mother and father, you as parents spoke to your child, whatever sounds you made, kuchiku or called them by all kinds of cute little names, that was a beautiful language to the child. And the way the child responded, probably because even the child may not even remember today, but the way he or she responded was the most beautiful language that a parent could have heard. But slowly it evolved, and then we got into something called the mother tongue. And how do you think even the child learned the mother tongue? Did you actually sit and teach him the rules of grammar and punctuation or all? How do you think the child learned mother tongue? Anyone?
Just by listening.
Just by listening. Sandhya, you're dot on. Because, you know, the child or we had the sounds all around us. And we heard nothing but those sounds, whether it was our parents speaking or the television speaking or the radio speaking or the neighbor speaking, we heard those sounds. And that's how we picked up our mother tongue. Nobody taught us rules of grammar. Unless we chose it as a second language or third language in school, only then we sort of connected, okay, I'm speaking this way because there is a rule of grammar attached to it. I'm pausing in my sentences because there's something called the punctuation to it. But otherwise, nobody taught us rules of grammar. In philosophy and logic, we call it the deductive way of teaching, where, you know, you have a lot of examples around you and then you deduce, okay, this must have been the reason, or this is the reason that why I'm talking this way, right? Now, I remember 22 years back when I came to Chennai, I did not know a word of Tamil. I am basically not a Tamilian. I come from Andhra, but born and brought up in, you know, the north and the east. So I'm quite familiar with the North Indian languages. But I'm telling in Tamil because I know a lot of you relate to Tamil. I did not know a word of Tamil. I always say that, you know, the language grew onto me. I had little kids around me. I had some of my family members talk. And then, of course, the movies, which have a major impact on language learning. Songs, music has a major impact on language learning. And that's how the language grows on you. Now, the point that I'm trying to drive here is, with a mother tongue, it's not difficult because your child has grown learning and you've spoken to him and you've given him that environment where he constantly is listening with those beautiful sounds. It's ultimately, please don't forget, it's ultimately sounds. It's nothing but a combination of sounds, right? Now, why is it so difficult with English? I know all of us have got this, I can't call it a phobia or we are almost maniac about wanting to speak English well. Somewhere we associate it with a good, refined personality. We can't deny it. I think that's one of the things which the British has left with us is, a well-rounded personality, a good groomed personality will always speak English well. But that does not mean that person will not speak other languages well. English is an addition to your personality. But why do some of us, especially, those of us who are strong in a mother tongue or something, why do we find too difficult to understand English or speak it the right way? Why do you think there is a difficulty level? Why do you think there is a pause or a hitch or a kind of a hesitation? And why are we associating ourselves with, a good person, a person speaking good English is considered to be kind of, well respected in society? Why are there so many combinations? Basically, why so much of importance to English? Any answers or any kind of discussion on that?
Because that's the language that everybody knows. So if somebody is a Telugu, so they don't know Marathi, whoever is speaking. So English is the main language that everybody knows.
That's beautiful, Jai, because I think that's one common language which connects us all, right? And we all want to speak that language well. Now, how do you think, who said that now? Can I know the name of the child? Arya, that was very sweet of you, sweetheart. Which school do you go to?
Vidya Mandir.
Vidya Mandir, wonderful. So at home, what language do you speak?
Telugu.
Telugu. And apart from Telugu and English, what other languages do you speak?
I also speak Kannada.
Wonderful. And how did you pick up Kannada, may I know?
So my grandmother knows Kannada, so I learned from her.
So does she stay with you or you go to Bengaluru and pick up this beautiful Kannada from her?
She stays with me.
So that means you have a nice flair for languages where you pick up the different sounds. Now, if you realize Kannada is a different sound, Telugu is a different sound, English is a different sound. But since you like it, you love it, so you kind of got a hold over the languages. Am I right, Arya? Arya, yes?
Yes.
Thank you. Now, okay, now you see, and you know what, dear parents and children and everybody who's listening to me, a child, when he's exposed to all these different kind of sounds, he or she picks it up very, very easily. Children don't have those kind of, compartments or closures. They're very open to learning. And here I speak about English. I'm going to come back to very specifically about English because I've been an English teacher and I know what difference it makes in a child's life as he grows up once he kind of masters it. Right? When I say master, a child may be good at speaking, but may not be good at writing. He may be good at writing, but may not be good at speaking. But a child who's got both is definitely a compliment. And that environment, I think we as parents and teachers will have to bring it around our children. Some of you might ask, ma'am, should we stop speaking in a mother tongue or should we kind of stop conversing in a mother tongue if you're going to give so much of importance to English? No. You know that when the child is with you at home, it's going to be a mother tongue. And the child goes to school, it's going to be all English. But don't ever make the mistake of allowing the child to think in Tamil or in Telugu and then speak in English. There will be a complete non-congruence of ideas. You will not match because English grammar structure is completely different from that of any of our vernacular languages. Now, I will just take you through a few slides by which actually learning English could be helpful. And then I'll come back to other points which could help you enjoy the language. But the bottom line to learn and appreciate English is there's only two ways to do it. You've got to listen and you've got to speak. Writing can proceed later, much later. You learn to enjoy the language as something which is very close to you. And you start speaking. You can make mistakes. It's all right, but you've got to start speaking. Now, these are the basic points which I would like to share with all parents and teachers and children, those of you who are here. Children, some of you would have gone through as a kid, but we tend to forget because we don't take it seriously when at a time when you're supposed to learn it. So I'm just taking you back to your kindergarten, to your primary classes, where these things should have been, kind of embedded in you. So I'm just kind of revising a bit so that you get your pronunciations and your spoken right, and eventually you'll start writing right. Sandhya, can I have the next slide, please? Yeah. So English as a language, and that's the topic of my day, understanding approach to language learning, how to deal with it better. Now, why language? As my good little friend said, it's an important tool of communication, and we kind of live in a civilized society. Without language, we cannot afford to. Yes, we started as, you know, all those hoochie-cooing and gargling and mumbling sounds with our parents, but we grew up to realize that there are different structures and different ways to speak and communicate in different languages. And civilized human society is what you got to tag. I will not go into the depth of informative, expressive, performative, no, but please understand language is extremely important and you have a lot of emotions attached to it. Next slide, please. Yeah, phonics and phonetics, two major branches of learning the pronunciation of your alphabets. Don't go into phonetics because there's a lot of science behind it as to where exactly the alphabet sound is coming. Maybe at a different time we can deal with it. But please, children, get your phonics right. That's it. Your phonics are the basic sounds behind each alphabet. You get them right, you believe me, you will start speaking like a pro. Now, when I say speaking like a pro, you don't have to sound like an American or a Britisher. You speak a decent, neat English without having the influence of your mother tongue. Now, when you speak English, I shouldn't make out whether you're from Tamil Nadu, from Maharashtra, or from Rajasthan, or Jammu and Kashmir. No, I shouldn't be able to make out. You speak English just as English. And that's when you get your phonics right. Can we go to the next slide, Sandhya? I'm just going to take you through the sounds of each alphabet. Right, 26 alphabets, but how many sounds? We have 44 sounds. That's quite a lot. And I want your children, as we go, children, parents, and friends, as we go through the slides, please pay attention on the vowel sounds, because you will realize that the vowels definitely have more than two sounds, and that's where the entire confusion comes. The consonants are very well behaved. You don't have to worry because they have just one sound, and we're very happy with it. But the vowels can tend to be a little, you know, confusing and can put you at the wrong places. Next slide. Now, A, we all thought A was just for apple, and that's how we make a mistake, right? Let's not, when we start teaching our children, let them use a whole lot of words. And as they use the words, probably you can make them understand that, look, this is where the sound comes. Now, when I said A has four common sounds, it's got cat, fan, map, jar, it's all the A sound, where your mouth goes really wide. The long A, as in make, take, stake, wake, your jaw again goes down. R in father, palm, path. O as in wall and all. Your mouth almost takes the shape of O, but it is not O. So the four sounds of A is A, A, R, and O. Now, how many of us would have actually gone through this? Right? So parents, I think this is where we just start with A's for apple, and that's what gets fixed in the child's mind, that A has only one sound. That is, we teach him by the picture that apple is equivalent to A. I think that's where we need to make a change. You let him speak, let him introduce him to a lot of vocabulary, speak a lot. And then probably you can see, this is where the short A sound comes and this is where the O sound comes. And that is how you tend to, you know, bring congruence into the child understanding how exactly to pronounce the words. And try kind of mixing them up, you'll realize your pronunciation is actually not in the line of order. Now, coming to B, B is very well behaved. It is simple. It's just the B sound, right? And B, when in combination with other alphabets, changes. But B basically has just one sound, B. The examples are in front of you. But sometimes B can, you know, it's got to be very, very quiet in plumber. You don't say plumber, it's plumber, it's dumb. You don't say dumb, it's bomb. That's where the B goes quiet. And believe me, children and parents, all this comes only when you read a lot, when you speak a lot. All these, even the people, those who have created this, these modules, or those who have come to a conclusion with all this, have been reading a lot and then coming to an understanding that, look, this is how it has been. C again, it's got two sounds. Though it's a consonant, it's got the K and the S sound. Now, going to the science of why K and S, that will take time. But for the moment, K is in can, cut, cat, cramp, candy. And S as in center, city, cinema, cycle. Can anyone of you point out as to where all does C get the S sound? Can you find a line of similarity running? Even if you take a wild guess, it's fine.
It's followed by a vowel.
Wonderful. Sandhya, was that you?
Yeah.
Thank you so much. Whenever C is followed by a vowel, now you say, ma'am, even A is a vowel sound. But I'm be very specific. It has to be followed by the vowel sound and then it will get the S sound. Right? So for the moment, if the children just get to know that, okay, C has two sounds, the K and the S, they're happy with it. Going to the nuances should be with more examples, more reading and more talking. D has nice, it's just the D sound and it gets doubled when two of them come together. And it's very clearly says D is doubled when it is preceded by a short vowel, right? So these are not parents, these are these small things, you know, you will be able to catch it only, as I said, sometimes this sentence will keep coming from me that we read a lot, we talk a lot, and then we understand these small, small things. But in the childhood, at the primary level, once we kind of embed it into our children's hearts, they're never going to forget. I never forgot because I'm very thankful to my school. My school way back in Dhanbad, it is somewhere back in Jharkhand, a small little beautiful school. It was Mount Carmel. And I still remember my teachers, the sisters and the nuns who were there. They taught me only with examples. And when they spoke, they made sure that they pronounced it right because we were asked to look at the formation of their mouth. We were asked to notice very carefully how their mouth shifted or where their tongue went or where the jaw moved or how much their lips extended. So that's exactly how, you know, teaching happened. And we didn't know, I mean, those days about, imagine about 30, 35 years ago, no screens, smart boards, nothing. It was my teacher who brought everything alive before me. And Ramna sir will definitely agree with me when I say that we still remember those teachers because they did not have any teaching aids per se. It was them. If they taught poetry, they brought it alive with their hands movement and their eyes and the change of tone. If they were teaching prose, they were teaching drama, they literally brought those characters in front of us, only with a change in tone. And they asked us to notice them carefully. So that is the kind of education we got. And today with so many accessories and so much to support, I think teaching has become quite more enjoyable and, you know, so much to depend on. Okay, coming to E. Sandhya says, ma'am, enough of the D and let's go to the E. E's got nice two sounds. It's got the E. The short A as in bed, leg, wet, pen, right? And the long as in E, he, we, me, she. Now, there are some exceptions if you see down. In words such as cape, pine, tune, find, the final E does not make any sound. Why? Because of the, again, the vowel combination. This is where phonetics will come into place, which can be a study in your post-graduation, but not at your school level. At your school level, children, all that you need to understand is the basic sounds. You understand the basic sounds and you've got your language right. Going to F. Just one. F. Feet, free, fun, freak, father, frown, shelf. That's it. Going to G. Two sounds. The J and the J and the G. The G and the J. As in Doug, fig, girl, grumpy. When G is followed by, again, the vowels, it says, and no, sorry, when the G is followed by by E, I, or Y, it says J. Look at the alphabets, look at the words, people. Giant, gypsy, gem, barge. It's got all the I and the Y and the E and the A after it, and that's where the J sound comes in. Get your words, get the examples right, and you will have your words right. H. Okay. Just one simple H sound where there's a sound, H sound coming out. Now, when I come to H, I remember a very beautiful scene from a beautiful movie of Audrey Hepburn called My Fair Lady, and I would suggest all parents and children to watch it. You know, Professor Higgins is teaching Audrey Hepburn the H sound. Now, in the UK, when you go to the villages, the rural areas, even there, the fine Britishers believe that they do not, the people from the slums do not have a complete power over the language. It's only the refined, the educated, the upper middle class or the high class people who have the command over the language. The slum people do not have a command over the language. So this girl cannot say her. She says O and L and I. She doesn't pronounce H as her. So what he does is he puts fire in front of her, a lot of fire, and he says her. He makes her keep saying her. Ramna said, if sometime If you can just show a clipping from the movie, it will really help your children, believe me. And he says when she's producing the her sound, the fire actually has to move. The fire has to get blown. Only then the effect of the alphabet her comes. Otherwise, your pronunciation goes for a toss and the meaning goes topsy-turvy. Imagine you saying height without the her sound. You can't say height and you can't say umble and you can't say Ike. You have to have the air coming out. That's what H is all about. Right? Okay, I. The next alphabet. Okay, H is silent and the nice little pop-up coming says H is silent in many English words. Honest, we don't say honest, we say honest. Right? And why is it so? Because honest has come from French. And so the French decided that the H will be silent. And we kept the silent, the silence, and but the H continued to say. So, but you can't say, ma'am, can't you write O-N-E-S-T as honest? No. Because there's a slight little air coming when you say honest. Very slight. And children, those nuances, as I said, will come only when you speak. Okay, coming to I, again, as a vowel sound, you have the short I as in hit, into, increase, inverse, split, and the long I as in bind, glide, pine, shine. Right? And the letter I often says its name if it comes before two consonants, find and climb. You will have to actually, I'll share the slides with you, you'll have to actually sit down, read it with time, and you will understand how it all happens. J, just one sound, just jaw, jump. And the interesting thing about J is there's never an English word which ends with the alphabet J. Try thinking about it, you will never find a word. Okay, now when I talk about all this thing, you must wonder why have I gone so much in detail. Now, just as Ramana sir loves dancing and he goes into the depths of it, so much as me, because I love the English language and that's why I go into the depth of it. And why? That's exactly why I enjoy telling you. Sandhya, I can make out when she speaks, her entire face and eyes speak, that's because she loves dancing and her entire face is dancing. Because there are two things which change. Why I'm giving these two live examples, because I find them right in front of me. It's easy and it's quite relatable. Right? Okay, going to K. Two sounds. K as in cake, silk, tank, bank. And when you have the K sound after short vowels, it's CK and pack and suck. You'll find the emphasis is more when C and K are together. Try saying it that way. It is pack, tick, speck, suck. You'll find a little pressure on this part of your throat. Okay, next. L. It's a beautiful little alphabet. L has one sound as in L, lips and lone and lovely, lamp, lane, and then the doubling of it. And in some places, the L is silent. Calf, yoke, calm, balm, right? Arya, there's a word with J as ending its hajj. I learned it from history. Arya, you must tell us the meaning of it, okay? By the time I come to Z, you must tell me the meaning of what that word is which ends with J.
Ma'am,
that
would be very interesting. Hajj is a pilgrimage to Mecca.
That is H-A-J. And Hajj comes from an Arabic word or a Muslim word which is not an English word. You go on a Hajj to Mecca. Right?
Yeah.
Super. But I'm glad you pronounce. You kind of had the common sense to say, ma'am, there is a word. And you will notice there are a lot more such words, in fact, which have kind of seeped into the English language from other languages too. Okay, we go to M now. Just one sound, it's M, your lips go close, M, mug, mouse, clump, Mary, Mary, M. That's it. And they double up with the short vowel, so the emphasis is more. Coming to N, just one sound again, nut, nest, night, nail, number, and they double up, so the emphasis is more. M and O. O is a vowel, so you can expect more sounds. Three sounds. A short one as in box, mop, coax, comb. Long O as in bone, note, cope, boat, note. Short A sound as in brother, done, front. Yeah, complicated, right? English can be really, really be funny at times and yet we love it. That's the beauty of the language. So look for more. When I share the slides with Ramana sir and he shares it with you, try looking for more words with the same kind of a sound. P, as in top, plant, pot, plant, stopping, and P is double. Very simple consonant. Q. Now, Q is a combination of K and W. It's qua. And if you see, Q is always followed by U. Just check it out. Quiet, queen, squabble, quilt, Q, quill, squid. You will never have a word with Q which is not without a U. What a wonderful thing is that, isn't it? But I must find children like RL who can say, ma'am, you're wrong. There is a word without where Q is without the U. Try looking for it. R. R, and R, there it goes rolling. Now, if I'm going to go into the depth of America and the British where the R rolls and doesn't roll, I'm not going to go into it. R is just R as in rob, roast, drab, rumble. And the combinations are there, which I'm not going to go into, but sometime later, S. Next alphabet. S, one is sir and the other one is z. Right? As in has, was. S never says z when it begins with the word. Z is used instead. Now, can someone tell me this? S never says z when it begins a word. Any word beginning with the alphabet S will not have the sound z. It will have sir. But when S is coming in the end, it could become z. Has, was, is. But miss is not miss. It's got two S, so it's miss. Right? And I think, you know, when we take each alphabet, we can have a lot of discussion on it, but on a later time. Next alphabet. T. T is nice with a T. Truck and pet and sit. And then combinations are there which give a different meaning. Now, T is for again, all those combinations are there. I'm not going to go into the depth of it. Next. U. It's got three sounds. Short U as in cut, bun, fun. The long U as in chew and uniform. And the short U as in pull. Sandhya, I haven't finished with the U, please. Yeah, the short U as in put, pull, null. Please understand vowels have more sounds, so you've got to be extremely careful. And it's an exception which says no English word ends in U, except for one word, and that is Y-O-U. Try thinking. It's very interesting. It's kind of very quirky too. Next, U-V. Now, V is, of course, only one sound verb, but here I want to make a short exception, which I tell all my students also. When you have words with V and W, when you kind of pronounce words with V, make sure you cut the lower lip, and it's vine and victory and vineyard by van. When you say words with W, it'll be world and when and where. Your mouth has to go round when you say words with W, and that's exactly, you get the right pronunciation. Try changing it and you will actually mess it up. Now, I'll take an example from here. Wine and victory. I'm going to put my lips round and say wine and wood tree. No, it's going to sound bad. Words like when, world, suppose I'm going to cut my lower lip. When, world. No, I'm going wrong. So these are the small things which you have to notice and get it right. So when you say words with V, cut your lower lip. When you say words with W, please let your lips go round. There comes W. Win, want, wind, wait, warm. Right? Remember to get it round. X. It's a mixture of K and S. So it's mixture, fax, six, Xerox. Nice. And then we come to Z. That's it. It's a consonant. It's got three sounds. Yellow, yet, your. Short I as in funny, silly. Long I as in sky, by. Right? So it's got three different sounds. And the exception about Y is it can act both as a vowel and as a consonant. That's why sometimes when we say a beautiful year, and you'll say, ma'am, Y is a vowel. Why aren't you putting an in front of it? No. Right? So those exceptions have to be taken care of. X, Y, Z. Yes? Who's this? Arya again?
Yes, ma'am. I had a doubt.
Arya, go on. Okay, Arya, keep your doubt ready. I'll just wrap this up and come back to you. Yeah? Okay, Z has only one sound, zoo, zone, nice, lazy little Z. And of course, it doubles up when we add ing to it. So these were the basic sounds of the alphabet, which I wanted every child and every parent to know, so that once our basis is strong, and then we are fine with going ahead with the building of the structure. I just have one or two more slides. Sandhya, the next slide, please. Now, this is very important, which I want all of us to know, is the paralinguistic features. Now, as I mentioned right in the beginning of my talk, is even when I am not speaking, actually, when I'm not letting out sounds of my mouth, my body is speaking. So this is what I call the paralinguistic features. Body language, gestures, facial expressions, tone, speed, pitch of voice are all part of paralinguistic features where they matter. Your tone matters, your speed matters, your pitch matters. Right? And when any one of these features is absent, there will be disturbance between the communication, there will be misinterpretations, there will be misunderstandings. Now, how often have you noticed, children, you're still small, I'm sure your parents will understand, even you as kids, because you all have phones these days, when you message something on WhatsApp, I don't know if you're actually conveying the intent of what you mean to the other person across, it's often misunderstood. When you pick up the phone and talk, it is fine to a certain extent. But meeting a person and talking, you will exactly know the facial expressions, which are kind of adding up to the person, what he's speaking. Now, when I'm... Ramya, I'll come back to you, darling. Okay, now when I'm talking here, when I'm just talking plain without any expression, sitting absolutely straight with my eyes not moving, my lips just moving enough to speak, I'm making a very bland conversation. I am not concerned about my tone or my pitch or the way my face moves. Sandhya, can we go to the next slide, please? Yeah. Now here, tone relates to the emotion. Now, for example, I'm talking about the lovely weather today and say, the weather is lovely today and it is extremely chill and quite strange to Chennai. My tone doesn't convey anything of what I mean. The sentence talks about a very happy moment about how lovely the weather is and how beautiful it is for Chennai to have such a weather. Now, when I'm actually having the emotion and talking, my tone is changing, my pitch is changing, and so are my facial expression. My eyes start talking, my cheeks start talking, and my hands also start talking. That's what communication is all about, right? It conveys your emotion, your happiness, your sadness, your irritation, your frustration, everything. Pitch is, of course, related to music, but it is very much related to your talk or your communication too. When I'm very angry, my pitch is very high. How dare you do this? It goes high, right? And when children are very happy, they squeal, their pitch goes up. I mean, that makes a difference. You can't have a child, you know, in low pitch talking about his or her happiness. No. The next slide, please. Volume. I can't be soft about, now, of course, unless I'm in a very sophisticated kind of a meeting and I'm supposed to maintain those protocols and etiquette, and I can very happily sound like it's beautiful weather today and be very calm about it. No. But here, even the volume plays a lot of importance in the way you want to kind of convey something. Speed. You're in a hurry, you're in a rush, and I want to finish. Excitement, fear increases the speed of your communication. Now, these are common features of every language, and of course, English, because all of us are conversing in that language, right? But all these things will have to, why I wanted to speak about these features is because they matter to the way we communicate in any language, right? Sandhya, the next slide, please. Okay, probably we could just try this. On what occasions might we speak with a low-pitched voice? Can anyone try?
Ma'am, when we're being somber, when we're trying to sound somber,
when you're trying to sound very dignified, and even though you want to actually scream, but you maintain a very low-pitched voice is because you want to sound very dignified and serious about things. Okay. Now, this is just a few exercises which any of you could try to appreciate the importance of paralinguistic features in your class or in your homes, anywhere. You can have the conversations this way. Sandhya, just go to the next slide, please. Yeah. Eye contact with the person you're speaking. Why do you think this is important? Now, one thing is when you don't maintain an eye contact, you're trying to shy away or you want to kind of hide something. How do you maintain an eye contact with so many people? When you're addressing an audience, it comes by habit when you start speaking. It starts at home when you maintain an eye contact with your parents, with your friends, with your colleagues, with your classmates. And even the the what do you call the meeting online, the online avenue actually has opened up. And that's why I remember in the beginning when Sandhya was saying, please switch on your webcams. It was because she knew the nuance of talking to people. Now, when I'm looking at the camera and talking, I know I'm addressing all of it, but sometimes I'm looking at the people whom I can see. But as a human being and as somebody who knows that communication is very important, so that I convey the right thing to the right thing to the person I'm talking to, you've got to maintain an eye contact. Don't shy away. Try that without having an eye contact. Try talking to people. You know, find it very difficult. Show no emotion. As some time back, as I said, show no emotion, no facial expression, and no smile, no frown. A straight talk doesn't happen. Do not change the tone of your voice. Speak in a monotone. Yeah, one straight talk. I don't change the pitch. I don't change the tone. These are some of the things people, please understand, you cannot do it because you're not used to it and you haven't heard such things happen. It'll be very strange if these things you try to practice because something which is unnatural. Right? Sandhya, is there one more slide or am I done? Yeah, thank you. Okay, that was about a few slides, which I just wanted to tell you people that, you know, our basics are very important and that's where we begin with. Unless you understand the alphabets, unless you understand the sounds, you won't get it. And whenever you remember, please remember, if you're trying to kind of converse better in English, please think in English. You want to converse better in Tamil, think in Tamil. It's going to be difficult, but not impossible. And so language is basically all about sounds. And importance to English, because all of us want to converse, all of us want to relate to what is happening around us, all of us want to somehow be felt important, want to make our presence felt, and that's why the importance to the English language. Right? So this was a little from me about how easily you could catch on language. And to the parents, those who are listening to me, and children, I think you and your parents should actually learn English better together. It's a two-way process. And when you talk more, you learn more. Share your stories, speak to them about what happens in school, speak to them about everything that happens around you. And believe me, you'll be better at language. And there are only two ways to better your language, is to listen and to speak. It's okay to make mistakes. It's absolutely okay to make mistakes. Otherwise, there's no learning happening. Right? So I'll just keep the field open. Any kind of questions that anybody wants to ask?
You can please unmute yourself and post your questions. I'm sure, I think we had one more too. We have a raised hand by Vempati Lakshmi. Did you have a question?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, Lakshmi.
Go ahead, please.
Yes, ma'am. Good evening. So when we're talking about English as a language, it has its own rules and there's a certain way you would pronounce a word. And so just the way you have the phonetics and the phonics, and that is what structures the language. Now, when you're talking about accents and how they influence the English language, because the English language, since it's the most widely spoken, you have a great number of accents.
Don't even say this when you go to Europe, that it's most widely spoken, okay? When you go to the European continent, don't even say English is widely spoken. They will not accept it for anything.
Yes, ma'am.
But to us Indians, yes, very much.
So, ma'am, how does accent influence such a language?
Accent, you are influenced by an accent because, you know, you just love it. Simple. You want to be like them. Sometime back, especially when the BPO influx started happening, there was this huge study about Americanization of accent and American accent and British accent and all of it. And then there's something came called standardized neutral accent, where you neither sound like an American, neither like a Britisher, but you just sound English as English. You develop an accent because you keep hearing it. Now, for example, if I know many of my children who go to the US for studies, and when they come back, they don't sound Indian. They sound very American because, again, as I said, you hear them and that's how you start speaking. It's not that you do it by choice, but it's by chance. Because when you keep hearing it, you get it that way. And you like it. And at the bottom of it all, as I said right in the beginning, when you love something, you want to do it. When you like something, you want to do it. You want to speak like the Americans because you find it quite welcoming and you love to be like them, so you talk. That's it. But to retain your roots and talk English like just as a normal Indian would, that's a charm in itself. There's definitely a charm.
Any other questions?
Anybody else has questions?
Yeah. Audience, please feel free to unmute. And Arya, you had a question. Was there a question by Arya? Anybody else?
Don't think it is silly or not. Is silly or complicated? Don't kind of diversify your questions. Just feel free to ask.
Ma'am, may I ask another question?
Sure.
Yes, Lakshmi, go ahead.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you. So, following up to my question, my previous question, since say the Americans and the Brits pronounce different certain words in different ways, is there no correct medium between them? Who speaks it right, in simple words?
Both of them speak it right in their own ways. Both of them are not wrong. Both of them are, neither are we wrong. Yeah, but if you say honest is honest, definitely it will be wrong.
Yes.
So there are certain things which are universally accepted, and the Americans and the British, again, as I said, they have the differences because of the influence of the environment, of influence from what is around them. Right? Britishers are very, very particular behind the science of the language, and Americans are quite flexible.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Bhargava, I have a question now.
Yes,
Mr. Rana. Mostly speak Telugu in my home. In my home, we speak Telugu. And if I want to, as a parent, I'm asking you, could you just give us some tips how to improve the language? You said the child has to come and tell a story about what happened. And both ways, even the parent also get a chance to talk to the child in that particular language. That one thing you told us. What else we can do as a parent to encourage the children to master? Right now we're talking about English. Let's talk about English. Where I can make my child, my daughter speaks better English than my son, I feel it. And it's the area of interest of that particular child. If you ask me more kinesthetic, even for me, language is a problem because I don't focus on the language. So what is that as a parent we need to do that... we can create that interest within our family to converse and...
So initially, Mr. Ramna, you know what? Initial years, make it bilingual. Have the conversations both in the mother tongue and in the English. And okay. Slowly, you kind of have to induce into the child that, you know, I'm learning from you. And when the child kind of feels important that, yeah, my parents are learning from me, he or she will start teaching you better. And believe me, they know better than us. And when they want to teach their parents, they will even go one step ahead to learn better things and come. They will increase their vocabulary. They will tell you all that they learned in school, all that they learned from their friends and everybody around them. And they'll come and share it with you. But just give them that space and the freedom to say that, you know, we're learning from you. But the initial stages, you have to begin with bilingual and not make it like a, you know, atmosphere where it's only English we speak. I find a lot of parents coming. When I ask the child what's her mother tongue, he or she says English. And they would be from a normal household belonging to Tamil Nadu or Andhra or Karnataka. Why are we going into this kind of, you know, false impression? It's okay to say that my mother tongue is Tamil or Marathi or whatever. But I will definitely learn the language because there's a need. Right, so begin being bilingual with your child, speak the language or share with both whatever you speak at home and in English, and slowly tell the child that, look, I'm going to learn more from you because you know better than me. And pepping up the self-esteem definitely works wonders.
Sure.
So Arya's question was, why is it that Q has to be followed by U? I mean, is there a reason for it?
Arya, you'll have to go into the phonetics, as I said, into the science of the language. And it's too early for you to know that now. And which class are you in, Arya, now?
Seventh.
You can probably wait for about 3-4 more years. And if you can study the science behind the English language, that will help you answer why there is a U behind the Q.
Okay.
For now, just understand this. But the science behind it, you will require some more years. And that's where phonetics come into place, not phonics. Yeah.
All right.
And I sure want to meet you with the right answer.
Yeah.
Yes. So thank you. Thank you. Do we have any more questions? All right, then. Thank you so much, ma'am. I think we had a very interesting session going behind the sounds of, I think we take for granted so many things, and you have nicely pointed out so many small things that we, even I'm like, oh, yeah, that's right. You know, it really makes you think. So thank you. Thank you so much.
It's been a complete pleasure, Sandhya. Thanks to Ramna sir and all the entire RAC team who's taking efforts, you know, kind of make the best of this kind of a situation. 2020 is gone, but 2020 has kind of left a lot of lessons for us. It's kind of brought humanity together. And my request to all the parents is let language be a beautiful connect between you and your kids. In the years to come, we never know where our kids are going to be. This is a godsend moment when we have our children around us. And let language be that strong connect between our children and us, whether it be English or Telugu or Tamil, Hindi, Marathi. It's just not... But I'm not bothered. All that I want is language to be that strong bond between the children and the parents and teachers and everybody around us. Right? So thank you once again, everyone, and wishing you all a lovely year ahead.
Thank you, ma'am. I'd now like to invite Ramna sir to say a few words.
Thank you, Sandhya, and thank you, lovely parents and children. Every week we do Rock Talks, and every week we invite speakers and they enlighten us. And today is a very, very special speaker where I respect her so much as a teacher, as a human being, where I was actually influenced by her, inspired. I got a lot of inspirations I pick up from people. One such person is Ms. Bharati here. So very beautifully you have presented it, ma'am. Why? Because you quickly... this is the first time I think the whole education system, when we studied, like when I studied English, it's totally different now. You will not believe, only today I understood how many sounds a single letter has. Oh my God, that itself shook me up. And moreover, why they say dance is a universal language? They say dance is a universal language. Now, style is, and representative English is a style. An accent, same English is spoken by different people, it changes, the accent changes. Because style, it's a community, then the style differs by a country, a community, and it depends on the individual also. So it's like giving me a different perspective. And I love dance. Now, it's telling me, you say you love dance, I think it's high time you should focus on style. You should focus on that particular language. Because it's all about communication.
It is. Now, before I close, Ramna, I'm sorry to interrupt here. I would request the parents also, of course, apart from the reading and whatever I have suggested, in case they want to go really deep and encourage children to prepare them very well. Of course, that's a focus and aim of every parent, I suppose. Please let the children go through the competitive examinations. You know, all the Cambridge assessments that every university or board has to offer, and especially Cambridge has a wonderful range of assessments which will actually help the children excel and know themselves better. But all that we have to tell the children is we're not competing against somebody but your own self. You're preparing yourself for a journey that is ahead. And one thing which I want to, you know, there's a beautiful philosophy of Hindustan School where I work in now, where our late Revered Dr. Varghese had left this statement, and I find it so, so apt. He says, every child is success and no child a failure. I mean, that sentence, you know, encompasses all the beliefs. And I think all of us, you as a dancer, me as an educator, all of us are trying to do, and all the parents who are here, we're trying to do only one thing, to see that, you know, all our children are success stories. And whatever we could do to make them a success. But one thing is for sure, no child is a failure. That we'll have to somewhere write it in deep into our hearts, that no child is a failure. We'll all have to just find ways and means to show them the path, guide them and take them along.
Rightly said. Thank you very, very much, ma'am. It's a pleasure. And this is the first Rock Talks. We're having it in 2021. And that's brilliant. You focused on language. Indirectly, you focused on dance, where it's endless. It's an ocean. I think you can keep learning it, keep enjoying it. So thank you very much for sparing this time. It's a brilliant session, and I got inspired again once again. I think I'm going to start talking with my children. I think with the family, we are going to enjoy the language. So thank you very much.
We'll have to, just as much as you enjoy dance, let's enjoy language too.
Very true, very true.
So thank you very much once again, and have a lovely evening ahead and a lovely year ahead.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you so much for those of you present here. This session will be available in our YouTube channel along with all the other Rock Talk sessions. So if you want to share it to your friends and family, kindly subscribe to our YouTube channel, which is Rock Academy of Dance. So you will get notifications of whenever the video has been updated. Before we go, I just want to take 2 more minutes of your time to announce that we are launching Arise, a brand new course starting tomorrow in the morning. But let me not say too much about it because we have the expert here. So just 2 more minutes of your time.
Hi, getting up in the morning adds smile to me and it adds a lot of energy. So I have designed a course called Arise. It's a 20-minute dance workout which will add a lot of joy to you. More than a physical fitness, it's going to add energy to you, where you're going to set your day right. So please do join me in Arise, which is starting tomorrow at 7 o'clock in the morning. It's just 7 to 7:30, where the 20 minutes non-stop dance session is going to be there. See you all soon. Thank you.
Right, so if you want to start your day with a bang, you need to join Arise so that you start your day with a 20-minute session where you just dance your heart out and your day will go as you expected, with a lot of positivity and a lot of joy. So, Ramana sir, would you like to add any few words to that?
Yes, sure, Sandhya. See, after so many years, I started taking class. Now, Arise is the first course where we are launching it tomorrow, where I'm going to be there, where I'm going to move. It's a follow me on session. Indirectly, you will also learn dance. So I have the experience of teaching dance to different people, from a 3-year-old child to a 60, 70-year-old people I've trained. And the important part here is more than a physical fitness. It is more about your mind and your emotion. It keeps you joyful. It sets a tone. So that is very, very important. Please take a feel of it. You can come tomorrow and take a trial, and it's up to you. I think, hope definitely you will enjoy it, because I'm going to enjoy doing it. See you all soon tomorrow. Please join. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. So if you are interested in joining, please do get in touch with your front desk or with us. You can, the numbers mentioned over there, you can definitely get in touch with us and join. So with that, we conclude this week's Rock Talks. Thank you so much for being a part of today's show. We will be back next Sunday again with another entertaining, exciting, informative session. So until then, take care and goodbye.